right. They need to control their pacing. They need to control their tempo. The late game is somehow harder to have that composure. But let's talk about the drafts here as we are now entering match number two for today.
The crowd's ready. You can already hear it there. Well, ladies and gentlemen, once again, Bali United Studio. Let's give them a round of applause for the drafts right now as they get onto it. Blue side, Malvinas. MDH on the red with the Kaja and the Fanny both banned out. Again, it's pretty similar to game one.
I kind of feel like this is just because it is a best of one. You're not entirely sure what the opponent wants to prioritize. So just go for this very, very safe bans. The Fannies, the Kajas, the 1-1. And 1-1 is one of those heroes that Mirko has trained so much on.
Yes.
And you have been rewarded because this 1-1, this marksman, it looks like nerfs are there, but they're like, so what, you know? Nerfs, I'm 1-1. I keep on 1-1-ing, like winning, but like 1-1-ing, you know?
You tried. I respect the effort.
Effort. The effort is more important than the result, okay?
I agree. Sometimes, right? But I mean, obviously, the 1-1. She takes those nerfs, and it's a suggestion to
like
her.
A boss,
It's a suggestion. It's just a suggestion.
A boss move, you know?
It's a boss move. 1-1 has been a boss for so long. So long, and I agree. I put right amount of time to the right hero, but you could see two games, two 1-1 bans, despite the nerf that I even thought was gonna be pretty big. Massive, pretty big, right? No more stun from that first ability. When it comes back, it's only an immobilize. But here, you can already see, obviously, that early game-centric ban towards from MDH towards Malvinas. The Hayabusa on the assassin, but the glue was left out. And we, okay, why is glue dangerous?
The skill number one, I mean, no cooldown practically. You just
slam,
hit him,
slam.
And then you just come to the animation and no cooldown. So
no cooldown.
It's just semi-broken, but we'll see here. In match one, remember, it was banned out in the first phase. Now, MDH, what are they going to answer with? It is going to be the hero that is the signature for the mid lane.
No, here's the thing, man. Like, a straight up counter.
Yeah.
Like, glue, you want to split up? Sure,
sure.
Man, split up. Faramis is going to use the Ghost Buster and exercise the glue because the glue is dangerous because you keep on, it's like trying to kill someone with a spoon. It's annoying and eventually you will die, right? You just hit him a bit, hit him a bit, hit him a bit. And I kind of feel like a lot of people are still like underestimating the damage of the glue, just like you said. Like, you just keep on coming to his first kill, which is not like not the best thing that you want to do, right? But because they have the Faramis in the early stage of the game, during the laning phase, it's not going to be a great time, but when it comes to the team fight, the Faramis will be smiling big.
Smiling big up until he sees the picks coming in from Malvinas, because the Lolita really does stop that momentum that the Faramis has. When you're clumped up like that, especially now with the ultimate being changed a bit, where you need to be inside of the radius of that cult altar, the Lolita is an even bigger counter towards it. Especially when you add on the Yeet with the real world inflation now, and just the utility that she has without the Ice Queen 1. That's the rebound, or that's the adjustment that they made towards Yeet. Still though, you can already see from the side of MDH, they know that they can't just go for this super crazy stick pumped up team fight. They go for a Ling just to provide a little bit more of that side lane presence, maybe a split push threat.
A solid pick as well. I mean, a good target for that Ling is that Eve, which is viable and perhaps the marksman for that second phase. But now you can see from the side of MDH, they are trying to limit the option for Joel Crew. Beatrix has been banned out. Perhaps they might commit to another marksman for their last ban.
Or not. I just want to have a brief talk about the first three picks for both teams. For MDH, they have a lot of single target ways to pick people off because the Cho, very notorious with the way of the dragon, and the Link as an assassin can solo someone out. And yes, the Ghostbusters can attack a lot of people, but using the Shadow Stampede just to pull someone out. So right now, in terms of how things are setting up, MDH, they have a clear way if they want to go for a pick-off composition. But I kind of feel like they need a way to be able to run away from a fight or get some AoE damage, because looking at Malvinas Gaming MVG, they already have a lot of AoE. They got the glue that, you know, the first kill can hit multiple people, but he will single someone out with a split. But more importantly, the Lolita, whenever people are clumped up, which you want to do when you have a Faramis, is going to get punished. Same thing with the Eve. So right now, we're talking about clashing of styles. Single target pickoffs going up against AoE damage and control.
Hello, everyone.
Very interesting indeed. But yeah, as predicted, MDH Esports will pick up a hero that might be an insurance for that late game, and that is going to be the Claude. We'll enter the gold lane now. Question is, MVG, what are they going to answer with here? A good hero, a good option here for them is looking at the Martin Vans. Not a lot of options, but Fredrin will be picked up for. Oh my god, Fredrin jungler, of course. Joker will pick up the carry.
Wow, the carry up against this composition, that's
very brave.
Yeah, it's a very brave option to go for, but now with the Lapu-Lapu, you can kind of understand, right? You can look at the carry and can actually melt down some of the frontliners here coming in from MDH.
Yeah, here's the thing, right? Looking at the composition, again, I just want to say, MDH, they can single target, they can choose their targets. I think that is a big advantage for them. So it is going to be a test of skill. If they are able to find the correct targets, then they're in a good position to win themselves the fight. When we compare to the side of Malvinas Gaming, you don't have to be too harsh on who you're targeting. As long as you can clump them together, it's going to be looking good for Malvinas Gaming. But looking at the draft, I know a little bit towards MDH because I like this pick-off first style.
We gotta see though, right, LaFell America? I mean, the 10 heroes that is going to enter the Land of Dawn has been set. You like MDH better? I gotta agree. So let's just jump into the Land of Dawn.
Let's dive in to the Land of Dawn once again for game number two. Match number two of the day as well. A best of one. Volatile. Both teams will try to top their groups with this one. High stakes, as again, we get into the mid lane. And so far in this tournament, we've seen kind of a mix, right? Just based on game one, obviously still very low data, but mid control doesn't always equal the win early on now.
Yeah, right now, Gnarn is establishing dominance in the jungle, forcing Prince Fran use the Retribution early and looking more into this composition. Dragon, he's gonna be way tankier, especially with the Vengeance. So looking at this, MDH, they really have to focus on what they're gonna do in the mid stage of the game compared to Malvinas Gaming, because I kind of feel like Malvinas Gaming, even though like they're early game centric, it's pretty good if they just want to stall it out as well.
Yeah, I mean, they have to wait level 4, right? Real world inflation, Numenon Blast, they need level 4 to really impact the Land of Dawn. And of course, MDH, they do need time. In a sense, I mean, Jogua on that link should be more proactive, but take a look here. Already, an aggressive maneuver on towards Steve. Will this be the first blood? I need my help. Will not pop that flicker just yet. No first blood in the first minute.
Yeah, you know, both teams, again, just respecting each other. Not even a flicker or just a battle spell burnt out there. You can see both teams, they're just trying to play it slow. But in the XP lane, Dragon here already doing so much early on the glue. Joga is going to be forced to back off. Even though they kind of traded, right? The Lapu, the King, was able to clear it out, getting a bit more pressure to set up for the turtle. So that's the question we have to start asking now. Who's going to start it up and where is the countermeasure from the enemy team?
For me, I would kind of say MDH should really try to force this out, because Gnarn as the Cho doesn't really need the level 4 to have a lot of crowd control. So I kind of feel like if they can push the pressure a little bit earlier, it would be benefiting them. MVG, if they can fight it out, then that's the way as well.
Yeah, good rotations already from the side of both Malvinas Gaming and MDH, but it is going to be Malvinas who starts the turtle up. The King already popping in that bravest spider. No ultimate for the spine as Gnarn tries to open up the map. Will be stunned up by Steffis. Gnarn looks for a play. Jumps in with the way of the dragon, bringing Harley back, and that's going to be Numenon Blast as well. Time to play, popped into the back, but it's going to be the Numenon Blast connecting on the three members. It's still Joga who finds the retribution. Goes on to Steffis. It's a 2-for-1. Joga now still in the midst of it all. Dragon dealing so much with the split. Gnarn knocking him up, getting out with the shunt. Who is the King? Jumps in, Prince Fran is low, Joga's low too, they're just going at it, and it is going to be MDH who wins it in the end. A slam slam in the end as well to smack Joga in the face to get a trade back.
A good setup from Gnarn initially, targeted the Yves, gets it, and he gets taken down early, which means MDH can force a little bit more fight, but MVG managed to find some compensation, taking down a member, and let's see, it's a reset for both, but MDH is still in the lead.
Yeah, like I like that both teams are playing towards their own advantages, right? Because MDH try to secure the mid laner first, picking it off first is very good. But we definitely see the power when it comes to MVG just by having this glue. Like, yes. Oh my god! Like even the ladies, like, please don't run away. I haven't been meta for so long. Let's fight.
Yeah, dude, you can see the glue practically just carried that team fight, right? He was 1v3 and he didn't even have the vengeance for the fight. So imagine with the vengeance how much of a threat the glue is. What do you do against this man?
This is not your jungle, this is my jungle.
Oh my god, this
my name is Dragon. I'm the jungle for this one.
Yeah, you can see four members have to come over towards the purple side. It's now Narp jumped in, dishing out some damage, bringing it back, or just a split, and he saves the vengeance. It's all good, man.
If four people were there, ready to initiate, and even he's like,
and a Faramis.
Yeah, it's like, I'm gonna split.
This glue, man, in this update, it's again a very prio hero. Let's see though, MVG, can they extract this hero? Because actually, MDH, their rotations aren't bad, right?
No.
Let's see, second turtle, who will get it?
We'll see, right? It is towards the bottom side, and as you can see right now, both teams are still trying to play around that mid control. But we're gonna take a look at Joga right now, as he's actually able to dodge away from Prince Francis' taunt. Narn making a mistake there, gonna be dodged away from. Need my help, or even with a Shadow Stampede. Both teams looking for it as Prince Fran and Joga wants to go for 50-50. Narn, an amazing actually kick there. It's gonna be Joga who gets caught out. The turtle was actually taken away by Prince Fran as the king jumps in, dealing out some damage. Hehe, gonna be able to use the Blazing Duet to clear out the mid lane. Dragon still surviving with the vengeance, still coming in with the split, and he survives the team fight. In the end, he falls to Need My Help, but it's a 2-for-1 in favor of Malvinas.
MVG with Equalize here. Take a look at the gold chip already in minute number 5. MVG Joel Crew almost picking up the kill earlier, but man, oh man, what a rotation. This guy rotates from top side to help the turtle. LaFell.
I gotta say, man, I kind of feel like we just gotta focus on the EXP laners, man, because the king as well as Dragon, they're asserting dominance, and MDH, this does show Need My Help on this Faramis is a very good counter towards the glue, because he had a lot of HP, but now Hehehe is trying to run away.
Oh man, Hehehe, not having the sprint, jumps back to the battle mirror image just for Joel Crew to pick up that kill, and now it's really shaping up to be the game that we expected, with Malvinas controlling the early game.
My god, take a look at the items as well here. Eve, Enchanted Talons are quite early, but another thing that pops in the screen is the items for that carry, LaFell.
Yeah, honestly, I like that every single team has adjusted. Instead of focusing entirely on getting one core item, they're just kind of like splitting up, making sure that they get some passes from the item, like the Fury Hammer, as well as the Steel Link Place, just to have extra stats on your hero so that you can actually do a lot in the early stages of the game and mitigate any kind of engagement that the enemy tries to fight.
Yeah. And right now, Narn again going in for that aggressive play. Two times now he's been caught with that play. He wants to set it up. He wants to be the one to actually look for these proactive movements, but with the amount of mobility from Malvinas and with the stun as well provided by Steffe, he's not going to be able to do that at will. And now Malvinas, knowing that there's no roamer for MDH, they're completely controlling that top side and they're taking the turtle right now, uncontested for free.
What I love about Malvinas gaming here is their execution is just so in sync, and they do not forget about neutral objectives like turrets and of course this turtle. They manage to find the third turtle. Let's see, MDH, they need some compensation here.
Yeah, Goldie's building.
No, honestly, like I'm looking at this game and I'm seeing what are they waiting for, because Malvinas Gaming, look at this, the damage is so strong and it looks like they're gonna engage onto the jungler.
Joga's gonna be caught there by the Numenon Blast, and the real world manipulation basically zones everyone away from trying to follow that play up. MDH losing Joga on a Ling now that's behind of that Fredrin. The King using the Bravest Fighter just to clear out the waves. He's gonna be punished here by a dive, and it's gonna be the King who gets picked off, who jumps in looking for some more sustain. He gets out. Steffe looking for stun, jumps in, flickers as well under the turret to just back smack him up. Harley surviving with one.
My goodness, MVG, they are stepping on the gas here. The King needs to fall in the bot side, but take a look at this. MVG, they are looking to grab more space here, taking the tier 1 bot side, and seems like they will not get it. Still, MDH manages to defend that turret.
Right now, MVG, they're just solidifying every single lane for themselves because MDH, it looks like they're kind of getting picked off one by one because Gunnar tries to get information, but because the carry is there, you're going to get popped so fast. And I kind of feel like this is creating such a big problem for the side of MDH because the glue is more tankier than the roamer. And when it comes to Joel Crew on this carry, he really doesn't care who's in front of him. So right now, MVG, they're getting their win condition. The king goes in, but he didn't catch anyone.
Gnar gonna be able to find a way the dragon onto Steffi. That's just the roamer. That's gonna be the backline charting by Prince Fan.
Oh, there
you go. Real roam ablation on top of the Faramis ult, as that's gonna be the blazing duet popped in as well. Harley caught low. Joel Crew still free hitting with a full HP bar. He's still actually going to be able to push MDH back, but it's MDH who finds the pick.
Man, I can see why carry has been such a prior today. Remember, in the first game, carry was also picked up by Black Wizard. Now, another teamfight is brewing up here, Mirko.
No, seems it's not like a teamfight when there's Dragon, right? It's just,
true.
Hey, he walks.
See, he's harassing.
He wants,
he's harassing the members of MDH. But again, the first Lord is up now. It's very, very critical situation, especially for MDH.
Gnart looking for the play, gets Prince Fran right there, but there's no follow-up, as that's the real-world inflation that actually locks them down. Need my help with no cult altar. Hehe. Gonna be gunned down. That's the damage coming through, and Hehe is gonna fall for the second time in this game to Joel Crew, who's absolutely massive right now. MDH, how do they contest for the turtle or the Lord now?
Honestly, I kind of feel like they gotta slow things down a little bit because they've been, okay, even in the fight where they're all clumped up together, somehow MVG forces MDH to go left and right, never together. So far, we've seen MVG controlling the movement of MDH. You guys have to split up. And when they do split up, it's usually the damage dealers all alone, making it so that they're very vulnerable to any kind of damage coming in from MVG. So right now, MVG, they're telling MDH, you go left, you go right. Yeah. I'm shot calling for you.
I mean, you're right, MDH, they need to pick their battles here. They do not want to get driven by the side of MVG. MVG now, with the Lord push, is now established, has established a 3,000 gold lead. But take a look at this, another purple invade perhaps.
Gnart again in the midst of it all, gonna be actually melted down there. That's Joel Crew dealing so much. The cult altar just to save him as Joga gets out. Doesn't get the purple buff, however. It's still Prince Fran who wins out that retry battle. And it is getting from bad to worse from MDH, with Malvinas completely controlling the map and even claiming MDH's jungle.
Yeah, right now, honestly, man, I gotta say, this is just the second game of the day, but we can see the strength of carry as well as Blue. MVG, they're sticking to their guns. They're actually trying to get one of the turrets here, but it looks like a very good defense coming in from MDH, but no, never mind. The King got caught,
what?
And the King is taking so much damage, but he still survives.
What is that damage, my guy? Oh my goodness, Joel Crew is an absolute monster on the carry right now.
You can see here MDH already executing the split push potential that they have, because take a look at the items, take a look at the gold here. Carry 8,000
no
gold.
No golden staff yet.
No golden staff
no
yet.
No golden staff
exactly.
yet. So this is crazy.
Explain.
Okay, here's the thing, right? It looks like in terms of the players, Dave, there's two ways that you want to go with your build. Number one, quickly get your Corrosion Scythe, your Demon Hunter Sword, as well as your Golden Staff. But if you want to play a little bit more disciplined, you delay the Golden Staff just a little bit so that you get your Wind of Nature first, making it so that even if you do get engaged on, you can survive if your tank or your roamer is not there to protect you. So it looks like in this game, Malvinas Gaming, they just do not want to lose their advantage that they've already piled up against MDH. So going for the safe pick, that's good.
That's so unfortunate for Gnar, man. He goes out to Harley, but the kick did not go through all the way. Still on the back line with a Blazing Duet, dealing a whole lot of damage, but Joel Crew does more. Dragon now onto Hehe, who has the sprint. Hehe's running for the hills, gets out with a Battle Mirror image, and it's a 1-for-1. Gnart for Harley, which is technically worth it, but oh my god, okay, we're good.
We're good. Don't snitch. But there you go, he made it. But yeah, back to your point here, LaFell. A very intelligent item from the side of Joel Crew. He doesn't want to. He knows he is dominant. He's
he has
dominating
enough damage.
Game, but he has enough damage, so let's be more respectful. But now, the Lord is up. This is Enhanced Lord, so MDH, they need to figure something out.
I kind of feel like if Joga can get a way to get onto Jokru, that's great. But we can see that Gnard has been trying and trying and trying, and every single time he tries, he dies. It's not a good situation to be in. And hey, just got down by Dragon! Oh. What did you do, Dragon?
Dragon, look at him, look at him! He just walks up menacingly and four people have to back off!
Dragon is just dragging everyone all around!
Oh my, look at him! Look at him! He's just walking with swag, man!
He looks like he doesn't care!
He doesn't care!
He dragged Hehe from the mid lane all the way back to the base!
Oh, he doesn't care, man.
He doesn't care. It's a good mindset to be in when you don't have to care.
This is why you ban Glue. I feel like in this patch, in this current tournament, if you're the first pick, you should fire Glue. And if you're the second pick, you just ban that Glue out. Let's see here. The offense and defense for both teams seems like MVG. With this gold established already, they might take two basers if they're lucky. If MDH screws up, let's see.
The king now jumping with the bravest spider.
What?
Oh my goodness, the gold altar isn't enough. He flickers out just to die toward Jokru. Oh my god, does he have golden staff? Please tell me he has golden staff now, right?
Yeah.
Mirko, Ghani, answer this riddle.
What
are you gonna do against someone that doesn't die and someone that does too much damage?
You run.
Thank you very much. I do agree. You run.
That's okay. It's a good riddle.
It's a logical answer.
That's a logical answer.
Yeah.
Exactly. But let's
it's not the answer I'm looking for, but it's logical.
Okay. What's the answer you're looking for? Well,
I'm looking for an engage by MVG.
And they are doing it right now. Need my help. Gonna be taken down. Gnard now, still trying to zone the other members away. Jumps in with the Jeet Kune Do, but is not gonna be able to find a way to Dragon as the King jumps in with the bravest fighter. But again, it's just a cult altar defensively. There's no counterplay right now towards what Malvinas are doing. They're even just walking into turret range of the base turret, dishing out some damage, sieging it down with no minion waves. They are absolutely controlling this game.
Looking bleak for MDH. They are now behind 6,000 gold. Oh my god, another engage.
Again, Dragon here. He just jumps in and he is going to be able to zone Hehe away with nature pop, but that's the magic damage coming through. Jokru, free hitting on the back, getting the double. The King, who has the damage reduction, will not be able to survive this. That's the mid base turret taken out without a minion. A single minion wasn't necessary for Malvinas. It's a triple kill over to Jokru. Joga and Need My Help now trying desperately to save the game. Dragon still able to jump in with a slam slam. Jokru targeting the base, and it's gonna be Malvinas Gaming who tops their group for now. 1-0 up against MDH.
The runner-ups from Latin America managed to sweep the win here in our second match of the opening day. Congratulations, but my god, what an execution by Dragon.